important that everybody gets their groove on a Wednesday morning.
It puts us all in the mood for instructional designing.
That didn't rhyme so well.
I know, I'm thinking, crap, now I've quartered myself. Got nowhere to
so
go
close.
With that one.
Yeah. How the heck is everybody?
Doing well. Lots of folks saying good morning in the chat, too, from all kinds of places around. A mixed bag of weather, as we always make a note of. So,
we are ready for today. We are ready for Wednesday. Chris, we have an amazing guest this morning. Who's hanging out with us in the other cube?
Well, we have, as was mentioned in the chat, the glorious Kassy LaBorie with us once more today. Kassy's been a guest a few other times on different episodes with us. But there may actually be folks in the session today who haven't met you or encountered you online, Kassy. So give us a quick bio, a quick introduction to yourself.
Well, thank you, and thanks for having me. I get to work with people all around the world each day, helping them figure out how to do virtual training, which, you know, before nobody knew what I was talking about, but now everybody knows and everyone's doing it. And so master virtual trainers out there are quite busy, but that's what I do. I hail from Rochester, New York. The sun is finally out, as is all the pollen, which is excellent. My entire house is covered in something yellow, which is really interesting. But I'm working with people all the time, helping them develop their virtual training strategies, their people, and also the instructional design side, and this idea of the producer, too.
Mm-hmm. I think that's what we're talking about today.
I think it's what we're talking about today, exactly.
What a coinky dink. No kidding. So, yeah. I mean, as you mentioned, everybody now knows virtual training because we've been doing this for last year in virtual meetings and virtual, with the variety of different tools that we've all had to shift to using in order to stay connected and stay informed, et cetera. And I think for a lot of people, it's just been a, hey, jump in, turn it on and see what happens kind of a thing. Yeah. But there's a place where maybe that's, you know, not working enough, or you've just at least managed to start swimming. You know, everybody's not feeling like they're completely drowning. So maybe there's an opportunity to take things up a notch and actually move from just being there to actually being in a better learning mode and that sort of a thing. And that's what we're talking about today with the role of a producer, that idea of the person who's sort of the glue, the making the things happen.
Well, let me just jump in here too real quick before I let you get started with a quick overview, Kassy. You know, everybody's dealing with Zoom fatigue, right? I don't even think the real world out there during the pandemic shutdown in 2020 even called it, like, you know, virtual training. They just called it online training, online. Let's just do it online. And then it just became Zoom. It's like, it's like Reynolds wrap, you know, it's always, no matter what brand you have, it's Reynolds wrap. But
can you FedEx this?
Yeah, right. Yeah. No matter what service you use. So now it's like, I'm going to have a Zoom meeting, whether you're in a go-to meeting or a whatever, like, are we going to Zoom? Are we going to do the Zoom thing? And so, you know, but everybody's tired of it, right? Very quickly, we came across the idea of Zoom fatigue. And the thing that was always gnawing in the back of my mind was, this is us. This is our industry. This is where we're supposed to shine. We're supposed to be able to step up and make this stuff better. And after a year of it, I feel kind of disappointed in us, which made me really start to think about the fact that I hope people really realize that you need a producer. And there's nobody better to come talk about this stuff than you, Kassy. So I'm glad you're able to join us here. So help us understand the what of a producer.
It's like, how many of you have been in a situation you're in your Zoom, which may or may not be Zoom. And it's time now to say, you know, someone told you should run a poll because polls are super engaging. So you have a poll that you prepared and now you're talking about whatever you're talking about, meeting, training, webinar, whatever you're doing. And then it's time to run that poll because it's engaging. And then you have to figure out where the poll is. you think you loaded it ahead of time, and you're supposed to still be talking about whatever you're talking about. And now you got to find the poll, and you got to find how to open it. Now you got to run it. And can people see it? Oh my gosh, how do I close this thing? Meanwhile, what was I talking about? And now I'm supposed to share, should I share results? How do I share results? Great, thanks for answering the poll, everybody. My next slide is on this other topic. Forget what I even asked, who cares? I mean, how many people can relate to that? Yeah, the process of running the poll and you don't even know what the question was, you don't know why you asked it, and how it relates to whatever you were doing. I mean, that might be an extreme example.
Well, but how many subject matter experts that we get involved with, right, just think, oh, yeah, I've been teaching this for years. I'm just going to do it online, right? Just show me the basics of this Zoom thing. I'll be fine. I'm great at it. You know, I can do this. I've been teaching this for so long. And then I think everybody starts to really quickly realize, or maybe they don't. I don't know. Maybe that's the problem. But that it's a lot harder. And there's a lot more sort of responsibility or things to be concerned about.
Yeah. I mean, there was just like a lot of stuff was managed non-verbally in person. And you all know how to be there in person. If I said, let's, you know, turn to a neighbor, you know how to do that. You're already at a table and desk and chairs that was all set up for me that I didn't set up. The building was already built. I didn't build that building. I just showed up on time and I maybe put out my handouts and arranged things the way I wanted it. But once we got there, you knew how to walk through the door. You knew how to be in that environment, in that space. Nobody was clicking on stuff for you to make that happen. And so I don't have to do anything other than say, get into teams of four, and you know how to do that. But here, WebEx, Zoom, whatever I'm using, I have to click on people and arrange that and then make it all happen and then help you with all the things just to get there to do the activity, none of which I had to worry about in person. And I think it's very interesting that we say that, well, my trainers always taught alone in person. I'm like, yeah, they did, but they didn't build the building. They didn't unlock the door. They didn't have to get everybody physically through the door. You know, y'all know how to do that. But here, clicking a link isn't enough.
And typically there's an AV person, right? Or an IT person, right? If you've got some media in the in the physical classroom, typically there's somebody that you can call and say, or yes, that just knows, they know the schedule of classes that are going to be going on and they're going to be there. And they always walk in and they say, hey, is there anything I can do for you? And do you need anything? You know, here's the clicker for the overhead projector, and do you have slides? Are you hooked up?
I always needed help with the projector. Yeah. Forget it. I do not to this day know how to make a projector work. And so there's always some help. And where's the donuts? Where's the restroom? You know, all those things. Yeah. It's like, I didn't do that stuff. You know, this is why we paid for the space and the building and all that business. And so when we went online, we sort of just dumped everything on the trainer, the subject matter expert. You know, and then you add to that, the attendees no longer have to put up with any of the mess. They can just log off, right? They're not going to get lunch. They're not going to have a great cocktail afterwards unless they make it themselves. So there was no motivation to hang out all day. And now I need the training to be better. The stuff you got away with in person is unacceptable online.
Yeah, I used to think I would be a pretty good producer just because I've produced regular TV before. Mm-hmm. I've been live streaming for years now, and you and I actually produced a workshop together, which went super cool, and I had the best time, and I learned a ton. But I also realized, oh my gosh, I'm really not that good at doing this. There's a lot. I mean, we pulled it off, right? But there was so much that I didn't know. And so it was, you taught me a lot. And then that experience of pulling it off made it great. And then there's producer Craig in the chat who helps me with.
He does great, doesn't he?
My producer stuff.
You know, I mean, and here's the thing too, that there's a lot of different ways to be a producer. Right. And there's different things. Like Jo Cook is here today and she's incredible, virtual trainer and producer and designer and all things virtual too. Hi, Jo. And she and I have worked together and, you know, we created things and built things together too. And it's like you start off, the basic idea of a producer is they're going to manage the tech. you know, so that the trainer, the presenter, the meeting host can lead on content. It's like if you break it down, content and meaning of that to participants is the leader of the meeting or the training. And yes. then you look at the producer and that's like technology and logistics. That's the basic. All producers are managing the tech, which doesn't mean that the trainer doesn't manage the tech at some level. It doesn't mean that I ignore all of it and just sit here. You know, I still need to know it too, but it's not what I'm leading on. So that's the basic breakdown. And then there's different ways to be a producer. And what's so interesting to me, what's happening right now is how the role is developing. So first we had just, hey, what about us? We producers, and I know you need one now. And now we're seeing growth and change. And I'm having people come to me and say, what more can I do as a producer? So if I circle back to the Joe example, Joe and I have worked together many times. And you know what, like when we first met, this is how we were going to do just the basics. But then as we grew in our relationship and getting to know each other and how our personalities are, there's things that we could then do. I'm like, you do that part. And then you do this and I'm going to do that. And we'll come in. And then all of a sudden it's like, you know, like how you are, Brent and Chris, how you guys run this, where there's like so much of the producer personality is part of the delivery too. And that's when we start getting into the TV broadcasting idea, right?
Yeah, for sure. Well, yeah. let's help people understand a little bit about what all of those details are. You have the best activities, and you said that you had one to help us run us through today.
Yeah, I have a couple of things.
Or am I premature in asking you to do that?
No, I think it'd be really fun. You guys, I thought, so I just launched, I have a new book out on producing virtual training, meetings and webinars, and I'm excited about having also a companion producer training that goes along with that. And so if people want to become producers, you need to reach out to me because I'm doing that now. And I have some example activities that that Brent and I talked about. Maybe I could bring in today and go with it, kind of to help you understand. You know, we thought like, what would be valuable for you today? Well, first off, what is a producer, or what are the production tasks? And then, how do I become one? And what are some of the skills that I should probably look at developing? But you know what? So let's do this. This is one of my favorite activities. And if any of you know Brian Washburn, this comes from him. He's an instructional designer. He's got all kinds of cool stuff that he's running as well. And this activity was his idea. So I want to give credit to him where credit is due, because I think this activity is so fun. Plus, you guys are going to get to laugh at me here in a second. You ready? Okay. Laughing made me right about now.
and coincidentally, Brian's going to be a guest.
Is he?
I don't even know off the top of my head, but I know he's coming up. I don't know if he's next week or the week after.
Oh, that's awesome.
I think 2 weeks away.
2 weeks away, that's right. Yeah, because next week is
Patty Shank,
yeah.
Oh, Patty. Yeah, you know, I know, and Brian's got a new book coming out. That's really cool. It's like the periodic table of learning elements, right? So it's cool. Cool. Yeah. But this activity is about helping people understand, like for him, it came from a sales thing, understanding your buyers, the anatomy of your customer or your buyer. And what I did is I took this and as a discussion for people who are becoming producers, it's the anatomy of the participant. Okay. And the reason I thought you all might get a kick out of this is because this is original artwork, Kassy LaBorie. So here we are. And as you see this and you guys,
do you have the copyright on that?
Yeah. I'm applying for it as we speak. So it's a time consuming process. All right. So the anatomy of the online participant is where I begin with helping producer candidates understand what kind of support they're going to be providing. Because of course you need to know the tech. Every producer, that's what you're doing. You know, the Zoom, the WebEx, the Crowdcast, whatever, but then what? And so to help understand the then what, it's like, you guys could consider this now. What do the participants that are coming to your webinar already know or think they know about being in the webinar? And you guys could chat about this. Let's start with the know. Every online participant, or think about yours, if we want to get specific, think about the people that are coming to your webinars that, let's say you're a producer, what do they already know? Those kind of things. Yeah, I know he is adorable and he's very busy, as Chris noted.
Drop it in the chat, you guys. What is it? What's the answers?
When I do this in my certificate, I put people into breakouts, into teams of three, and they go through discussing this, taking notes on this page. So what do your participants already think they know when they are attending a virtual training or a webinar. The other thing that we have in there, they think they know how to log in, Kevin, they're right. They probably do, but then they get that wrong, don't they?
And then you get all the phone calls.
I think that they think they know what the experience is going to be like.
Yeah.
I know this is going to be boring, so I will fill in the blank. Be checking my email, doing my laundry, whatever it is, right?
Yeah, I'm probably just going to have to listen for an hour. So
yes.
I don't have to have a headset on. I don't have to get dressed. And then all of a sudden they realize, oh, wait, they want the cameras on.
Yeah, I know. And then we're getting into some specifics on, like, they think they do know stuff about how to set their virtual backgrounds. They think they know how to act. That's interesting, Harold. They know how to act. They think they do. They know how to use the chat. So, you know, and then why does this stuff matter? So when you're starting to look at, I'm trying to get the producers to think about, yes, you need to know how to make the poll work, but let's start to move to what about how you support the people? And when you start to look at what people think they know, look at what we're dealing with. And they may or may not know, is my mic working? Yes, you know, I know how to do this. I'm focused on my virtual background. And are they caring then about the learning? So how does what they think they already know impact how you're going to support the session? And then what about feelings? If we move on to what are participants feeling when they come to the session? And we just can kind of have a conversation around that. And how does that then impact the kind of support you may need to provide them? Like Chris and Brent, when you guys have speakers that are on for the first time, I'm sure, like, think about how we as speakers are feeling as your guests. How does that impact how you support us or what you need to do to make it successful for us?
Yeah. So I mean, from a no, we do find that people know
cares,
other tools,
right?
but Crowdcast is a relatively limited tool. Am I on?
Yeah, you're on. I hear you.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Sorry. I just, I actually had click mute a while ago and didn't realize if I'd taken it off or not. But and first time presenters are trying to remember everything that they know. And also try to adjust to this whole thing called Crowdcast, for example, as a tool. Like we did with you, how do I even share my screen? Because it's not in the same place where it is in other tools. So that's that combination of feeling like, oh, I have to be someone who knows everything, but I also have to be successful, you know, with the tool and unsure necessarily with, how to do things.
And then ultimately, how does that impact what you have to do here to help this be a great session where you featured that speaker? You know, what kind of things does that do? And to have that kind of consideration is starting to get into the depth of the role of the producer, you know, where a lot of people say, well, it's a luxury to have the producer. Well, is it actually? I mean, do we want to be successful in these efforts? And we talk about this idea of blaming Zoom for the Zoom fatigue. It's online meeting fatigue. It's being alone in an office all day, but not ever alone fatigue. Zoom got blamed for it because of the popularity of Zoom, right? But it's fatigue of staring into a camera, fatigue of being bored, fatigue of all the stress of it. And so you start thinking about the depth of what we are experiencing, and a producer can come in and begin to help provide support to help trainers be better at what they're doing and participants more effective at the entire experience. And then that last question is, you know, what have people experienced with technology? And then again, how does that impact the kind of support you provide? So you could see how this gets kind of complicated. We can have like a whole theoretical day on just this one thing, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's neat.
Sure. And so what is, what do you guys, I'm trying to catch up on the chat and see question, right? What have participants experienced with technology? I think everybody has experienced, has had bad experiences with technology, right? And they've experienced microphones not working, and it was working in my last meeting, but now that I'm in this meeting, I don't understand why it's not working. You know, there's that, there's...
And then that whole thing impacts, like, what if we're here to be learning about a new process to help us better do our jobs? But all I'm worried about is my mic working? I'm not learning that thing. And so producers coming in and helping. And if you don't have a producer, let's just be honest, if you don't have a producer, then this is a production task. So now you, as a solo delivery person, have to decide, how do I support all the mics not working and at the same time still get through the content of what we're doing that's supposed to impact how we're doing the job that day?
Right. And it's, you know, it's going to be a little bit different between whether or not you're doing this internally and you know every, you know the exact tech that everybody's got at their desk or, you know, inside, you know, one corporation, or at least you have a basic idea of probably what everybody's got and what they're using and how they're all connected. But if you're running something externally, maybe with customers or whatever, that's typically where the unknowns lie. And that's where all the problems start to come up. So if you were going to ease into, if you're like a training manager and you're trying to decide, do we spend headcount budget on a producer or take one of our instructional designers and say, hey, let's train them up and give them that producer role. I think that would probably be the best place to put them for starting out.
Like if you're trying to train up your trainers to be virtual trainers, you want them to be better, team up two trainers together, putting one in the role of the producer and the other one as trainer, and then have them swap the roles. And what happens is they both grow their tech skills while they're teaching. And then you have a team of people that are supporting each other at the same time.
That's a great idea.
Yeah. The other thing is this, when looking at like, so that conversation around the anatomy of the participant helps to get to how you're going to provide support. And I thought I'd back up and just share here. If you had the question on like, how do I become a producer? What's the skill set? What am I looking at building if this is a role that is of interest to me? This is the way that I decided to put them together as a, sort of the bucket of the main things. The first bucket being, of course, a producer knows the technology in and out. They have learned it, they can use it, and they can fix it. And that's the first and foremost. And then if you're adding on to that, and this is what that conversation is around the participants, and Harold, you know, helping the experience to be meaningful, this is where you're talking about producers helping to support the entire experience, getting everyone connected, which would include the trainer, right? partnering with everyone, partnering with the tech, partnering with the participants, obviously partnering with the trainer. And then in the moment, being able to analyze situations that are occurring, like, you know, knowing that the breakouts are coming and being able to decide who should lead that breakout because you've been listening to the participants and, you know, you don't want to put three very quiet people together. You want to have one that will talk at least. So paying attention to those kind of things and analyzing not only tech support problems, but also situations that might preempt a possible problem that's coming up. And all the while, this is another thing too, that is a place for producers to look at growing and making the role even more in this area of upping your communication skills, really listening. Rather than jumping to conclusions on what might be wrong, being able to present information in a way that people can hear it, understand it, and be able to act on it. And then I have this appear one as the last one because reality is we're on webcam all day nowadays. And so, you know, you don't need to look like the tech support person hiding out in a cave, right? So if you want to up the game, at least.
Get some FaceTime.
Get some FaceTime. And, you know, people have been asking me, like, who are the ideal candidates to become a producer? And I think in our world today, there's so much opportunity. And I can tell you guys that I have people coming to me, companies saying, who have you trained? Who can I hire? And the people that I see doing the best in this role are, if you have ever been a technical trainer, you teach software, you are a perfect candidate to be a producer and help the whole world because you're already a bit of a trainer, right? You already are. And then you know how to help people understand and use technology. So you're like the perfect candidate. And then the second person that's another great candidate, if you're an instructional designer and you want to become like a television producer, like Brent, you mentioned, every single session I've ever been in, and Joe can attest to this, if I was the producer, that trainer did not know what they were doing and they wanted me to tell them how they should run it. And that required some instructional design expertise, if you ask me. Mm-hmm. Bringing a whole experience together that's far beyond click on this poll. So it's a place not only for instructional designers to consider maybe adding on to the work that you're doing if you're interested in such a thing, but it's also a place for people who are producers to look at growth and ways to look at professional development within the role that they may already be in. Cool.
Craig has a question in the chat, and it might be a good time to bring this in since we've been kind of dancing around it. But he's asking, which is more of a challenge, managing the tech or managing the people? And he does put in brackets, generally speaking. I know it varies per event.
Is this like, what does the group think? I'm so interested, and that'd be a great poll. And I wonder how much of the role that you currently have informs this answer, you know? I mean, for me, I think it's the people, but, you know, people are far more complex. The tech is click a button, you know, so that's me. And I am about as tech as they come when it comes to teaching online, for sure. But
the tech has no, the tech is nothing without the people trying to use it.
Yeah, so the tech has an answer.
Even it's managing the tech is still managing people. Yeah.
That's a good point, Chris. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm with Ed. I said that in the comment section of the ask a question, I put the same thing Ed says, people using the tech. So it's not, it's the tech and the people. And then you know, it's not either or, it's mixing them both together. And then, you know, when you get them in the same virtual room, that's when the troubles start to pop up. So,
right. All right. I mean, it's amazing. It's such an opportunity. I don't in any way see a producer as a less than role. For me, it is very much an equal to. Very much. If not, in some cases, more than what I'm doing. You know, like maybe a lot of cases, especially as we continue to add more tech to the way we're delivering our online programming, for better or for worse. There's so much that a producer can do. And Joe brings up the point too, that the producer can often provide partnership and support in such a different way. Like when I'm a trainer, I'm delivering and I'm really wrapped up in what I'm doing. I'm trying to deliver what I'm doing. And then you have participants wrapped up in what they're learning. And we each have feedback for ourselves on how it went. The producer has the perfect view because they don't have as much ego at stake with the delivery, and they also don't have much vulnerability with having to learn it. And so they can really provide amazing support and feedback that can help delivery be even better because of the situation they're in. It's so cool.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think it's an important point for us to highlight is that it's not, no, nobody's, you know, you're not the nerd in the sixth grade classroom running the projector because the teacher asked you to. That's totally not what we're saying. It's not that role at all. It is absolutely equally as important. And I think the success of whatever you're doing, whether it's a workshop or a training or anything at all, 1 hour, 4 hours, whatever, you know, the role of the producer is as important as the person standing up and delivering the training in it. I hope it gets situated that way within the hierarchy of HR within organizations, right? Everything has to be kind of put into a box, I know. And you know, when people are starting to hire for this role and whatnot, I hope it's not seen as a less than or an entry level sort of thing into the next thing as the instructor or whatever.
I think it is currently seen as that, Brett. I think it is. And here's the thing. That's why it's so important for people to just, even if we're starting there, so that's the world, we're starting there, but then there's so much opportunity. And I'm hopeful. And that's why I'm teaching it from this angle and why I wrote the book in the way that I did, because it is so much more. It isn't less than in any way. And there's opportunity for growth there too. As we look at the reality of what you talked about with the production of a show, you know, the production of a learning event.
You know, some people know who the director, like who directed a particular movie, but how many people actually know who produced it, right?
They
hide behind the scenes, but the producers are extremely important to make sure that that movie or show or whatever flies or doesn't fly.
I mean, I think it's like we start with this idea, though, of the basic, and even if it is entry level, at least people are now saying, I need some help. And frankly, that's where a lot of people are most comfortable in the role of producer at this point in time. And then once you get in there and you establish, I know exactly what I'm doing. I've been working with this trainer, this presenter for a while. This is when you can start to grow the role even more. And I think, too, that's why there's different types of producers. In my book, I talk about every producer is a technical producer. managing the tech. I also outlined one that I call the facilitative producer, which is also a trainer, and they are able to facilitate as well. And the other kind of producer that I have is the start time producer, the one that just helps everyone get connected and then they head out. And that's for the people that are really, really scared to commit to a producer. At least have somebody help everyone get connected. And, you know, we talk about like producers are going to be managing problems. And I introduce people to my RPA process, which is relax first. If you're freaking out, we freak out with you. Pinpoint the problem. Is it everybody or is it just one person? And then ACT, which is another process that I use for learning technology, which is access, click, team up. That's what ACT stands for. Let me in, let me click on everything, let me team up with other people to learn how to do it, or at the very least, a second computer. And so the ACT part of the RPA process is about being able to fix whatever problem it may be. And so to help people implement RPA, if you will, and to help them understand what kinds of things you would be doing, because having looked at, okay, this is a producer, here's the skills I want to consider growing, and here are the things that I would be doing. This is the way that I run this activity. Again, I do this in breakouts, and I have this table here of would you rather. And as you can see here, you guys, this is just fun. I think this was the most fun to put together. And some of you that have been doing virtual training, I think you could see why. But for example, would you rather help them with their internet problems or their audio problems? What does the group think?
Drop it in the chat.
Yes. I'd rather help them with their internet. I'd rather help them with that mic. I can't make my mic work. What's the phone number? This is such a fun conversation when you put them into breakouts and people are talking through it, because, you know, why? Why would you rather help with audio than the internet?
This is obviously coming from experienced webinar deliverers or online virtual training deliverers.
Yeah. They would all rather help with audio. That's so interesting. Why, you guys? I'm so interested. Why?
There's a lot of unanimity going on with that.
I know.
Choice.
Wisdom of the crowds.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We'll see if anybody wants to chime in with an explanation of why they've chosen audio. We'll give that a heartbeat. I've got a hunch. Yeah. Anika has tossed in. In the area settings that I would have suggested. Yeah.
I mean, the one big thing is that if their internet's not working, you're probably not connected to them and you're probably having to like get on the phone with them, or they're using their phone to email you. It seems to be more difficult to access whatever the problem may be. At least with audio, they're on the internet and you can chat with them, right? No controller of the internet. That's right. Yeah. All right. So here's the thing. As people go through this entire table having these conversations, what I'm asking them to do is to consider why. And then have a conversation around that with each other at the, you know, the things that they know and what are they identifying about their own skill set? Where do you have an opportunity here to better understand internet connectivity issues, right? Potentially. Another one of my favorites, you can see I just went through, would you rather produce a webinar or a training? Why? Do you want to help them with their webcam or their headset? What's your preference? I think they're both awful. I'd rather troubleshoot polling or breakouts, you know, what do you want?
The question about a webinar versus a training, I think might expose many people's assumption that a webinar is a training.
Yes. Yeah, there is that for sure. What's the difference? And now you've identified, okay, well, I think you need to figure out the difference. People have an opinion about what the difference is on those two things, you know? And here's the thing that ultimately this is ultimately what we learned from this. I mean, and maybe you guys are already seeing it. Guess what? It doesn't matter what you would rather do. You're doing all of it. And this is just eight.
It's going to happen.
It's going to happen. And this is a particular favorite one here. And some of you can probably relate. As a producer, would you rather send people the handouts that they did not know they needed in an email once the session starts? Or would you rather try to make it available via a link or a chat or some other kind of instant download option? Because they never realized that there was a handout, and they always need the handout right when you click start. And they click join, and their mic is finally working, and their webcam is finally working. And then they go, the next question is, oh, I didn't get the handout. So producer, here's the trainer. Producer will help you with that. Would you rather email it or would you rather make it available for download? And you guys, this one is a visceral one for me because I ran, recently I was running a session at a conference. It was a big conference. And I was so excited to do a scavenger hunt, which some of you may have seen me do before. I send you out to our website. You find the answers to the questions, blah, blah, blah. So fun. You win a gift. I sent them the questions. I prepared this beautiful document. We were in Zoom and I put the document in chat. And I'll tell you, 50% of the hundreds of people that were there, I can't get the document. Ruined everything.
Oh, I'm sure it still went well.
Of course, we made it go well. I put the questions on the screen in the moment I had to, and then they had to toggle. It was fine. But I tried to make it available via download, and people are still blocked from that link. In a public setting, right? They are. They can't go to that Google Doc. They can't download that file. They're restricted, even if the feature was available. So now you're like, oh, I wish I had all their emails and I could just ask the producer to fire off an email. I'm blocked from receiving emails from unknown people. I can't have an email with a download in it, right? There's all these different things. So either way, this is stuff that has to be managed up front, right?
Yeah. Yeah, and it's just, it's that understanding. It's going through that experience once before you really start to realize those things. Like if you do go to present something that you've always presented in a Zoom, but now you're going to do it face to face, but you're going to kind of do it semi-virtually or whatever, you're like, oh great, I've done this a million times. And then you go there and you're like, oops, yeah, I forgot connectivity is weird in a hotel. You know, there's a VPN thing and everybody is constrained as to how much they can download. And if you got 50 people in a room trying to download a 5, 10, 20, 30 megabyte file, everyone's going to get shut down.
Right. I mean, you know, so there's problems no matter what way you do it. And the key thing is knowing that it's going to happen and that you're going to have some kind of solution. And so this particular activity brings up a lot of emotional stuff for people, you know, and it's also just like insight into a segment of what your life will look like as a producer. And maybe it goes back to that question that Craig asked, would you rather deal with the tech or the people? And a lot of this is like both, right?
Yeah, I think I'd like to just point out, if it hasn't become, you know, particularly obvious to people in the chat, that this is something that I've noticed that Kassy and others who do this regularly, I know Joe does it as well, and others who have specialized in this virtual training, but helping engage people online. And to know that you don't have to be, as a training professional, you don't have to be the person up there always filling the air. It's okay to have dead air. And actually, sometimes dead air is good because people start to feel uncomfortable and then they all of a sudden feel like they have to engage and say something. Mm-hmm. And having activities like this is super valuable because it keeps your people from wanting to go check their email or whatever, because it's like, oh wait, I got to pay attention now. Wait, what did she show? What question are we talking about? You know, and oh, I have to engage now. That kind of thing. And it's
right.
It's huge. I mean, and it sometimes some people might look at some of the activities that they've seen in books or other things, and oh, that's silly. I'm just going to skip that. That's useless. And it's like, no, actually, that's not useless. That is that little activity just taught all of your participants how to use a particular feature. I loved that when you and I did that workshop and we went through that process, and to see light bulbs go off for everybody that was in that workshop was like, oh my gosh, she's right. It works.
It just works. It's like Joe was reminding me that there's this thing I always say, what did I just say that I could have let you say? Or what did I just do that I could have let you do? And you know, there's so much that you can do. If you go back and take a real honest look at your presentation, at your training, where are you being bossy? You know, where are you being controlling, and where could you let it be more about your participants? The best trainers, the best presenters, they make it more about the audience than themselves. You know, and that's like I used to work for Carnegie, and that was an old Carnegie thing. Like, you know, the more you talk about other people about them, the more they remember you and about you. It's amazing, right? It's not exactly how it was said, but that's the general sentiment. So, yeah. It's amazing to do that. And so letting people do more and try more is just key. And having a producer there to help you manage that so you can feel less fearful of it breaking. Because that's the thing. I'm just glad they connected. I'm going to smile now. Everyone, don't move. I got a lot to say and I'm going to get through it.
I got 120 slides here and we've only got about 35 minutes, people.
Don't break it. Yeah. Yeah.
Joe, we all go through that.
Joe in the chat has suggested more facilitation, less presenting, which is what it comes down to, is getting out of the role of being the person doing the dump of info and then to moving towards having people actually take care of the learning themselves.
And it's hard, you guys, it's hard, like, especially as we come upon conference season coming back. I mean, people are there to see presenters. And so there's certainly a time and place, and you have to be a credible presenter that people trust and respect. So it's not like I'm saying don't present, but it's like, really, the more you can make it about participants, the more that they will remember you. The more we make it about you, the more they remember you. It's amazing. And so I don't know. We have, if I keep on talking faster, we can get through more content. So what questions do we have? Who's got the first one? Love it.
Yeah. Let's just make this conversational. That's always mine. That's my go-to.
Yeah, I know. You guys are really good at that with the whole way that you run this entire series. And this audience, too, all of you are always so willing. I mean, let's talk about that for a second.
Yeah.
You do need to prepare your audience to participate, which is a lot of fun peas to say. Prepare your participants to participate. They're not ready. So I have had people, actually, it only happened once, but I love it. It had a big impact on me. Will you please stop calling on me? I'm in another meeting. You know, like, oh, okay. Sorry, my bad.
You know? I'm sorry, I thought you were here for me.
Yes, exactly. So participants aren't necessarily ready for everything. They don't know how to go through the door, choose a chair, sit down and raise their hands in every single tech.
Yeah.
So there is, and so like Brent, it reminds you me of when we did our session, like I was secretly teaching people how to be there at the same time that we were gathering. Why are you here? What do you want to learn? It was like, ooh, I also secretly just taught you the annotation tools. You didn't even realize, you know, they don't know. Not only do they not know how to use the tools, but they may not be ready for you to even ask them, like emotionally to use them as well.
Right.
So there's some care that needs to be taken in that moment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
One of my first coaches in sort of the online virtual space, he had a little trick and I've always remembered it. He just, he did an audio confirmation asking people to go to the chat and let him know that there was no audio issues as they got started. But it was that embedded, like, here's where the chat is. Start using it and, you know, breaking that kind of reluctance right away under a very gentle, you know, model. There's no pressure. Just let me know. Are you guys hearing me okay? And then into the chat. And then people knew where the chat was. And I went, that's very sly. It's very low pressure.
And I love to do that too. And I love to have it and to take it like next level. So that first one is yes, right? Or the thing is, you're going to get a bunch of no. You're not going to get any no's in that particular case, right? So you're leaving out. But like the other thing is to just ask them. And I think Joe and I have done this before. Here's a new one. What's your working from home name? Hey, everybody, before we get started, really important. What's your working from home name? Go to the chat. It is the how you're currently feeling and the last thing you ate. So I am the excited eggs. Happy to be here today. How about all of you? And the next thing you know, they're using the chat. You know they've heard you. And you can have your producer looking out for who doesn't respond if you're in a smaller group than you know what we have here today, but you could see who doesn't respond, and then you're like, oh, maybe it's not working for them, or maybe they're like just not emotionally listening yet.
Yes, the tricks of the trade. These are them, and they are in your book and all of the other places that you do your work and the things that you do. So be sure to drop all that stuff in the chat. There is so much more that I think in general needs to be discussed about this. And I'm so glad you do the workshops and the certifications. And I sure hope people take advantage of it, because it's something that the industry needs. And I'm glad to hear that you're getting people asking to hire folks from the industry too. I think it's absolutely critical. So
yeah, you guys, like, think about that for a second. You know, people need this role. I was in two meetings yesterday with companies looking for people to be producers. So if that's you, you need to message me right away, because I need to send them people and make me look good, okay? Y'all need to make me look good.
Yeah, and that's what we're here to do, Kassy. You always look great coming on the camera anyways, but I hope everybody watching thinks a little bit more about being a producer or adding it to your skill set, or if you're a manager or a CLO, I hope you'll start thinking about helping your teams level up. Chris, any final thoughts?
Just Patty Shank is joining us next week. And Brent, I don't know if you've got the LinkedIn group. We're going to be posting some follow-up stuff to today's session in our LinkedIn group. Kassy, as always, thanks so much for being here. This is fabulous and fantastic.
Thank you. And, thank you for having me.
Yeah, we'll have you back again, because this is something that people still need lots of help on as we go through this stuff. Even post-pandemic, things will be shifting. So very cool. Folks, let's dance on out of here.
Yeah, let's do that. I hope everybody goes to that idiotic group in LinkedIn, and I will approve you right away. Thanks again, Kassy. You're awesome. I'm going full volume for 20 seconds, and then we'll just keep enjoying our coffee. The big finale.